Our next speaker needs no introduction because he's been that as the process goes along, I realize just how hard these people have been working with their presentations. Because I've really done a fancy animation for you in mine, but you'll see that later on. I'm an amazing animator. What I'm here to talk to you about is something very important for those of us who work in the engineering, implementation, design, even administration space as support professionals for wireless networks. Wireless networks of all types are essential to modern business operations, and the reliability of those networks is absolutely important. We need to be able to assure our users that their wireless link is going to work. We need to make sure that our users can trust that the wireless network will be there when they need it. We need to make sure for our IoT devices that the wireless network will function as it needs to function when they need to communicate information that could be not only mission critical, but possibly life critical. So it's very important for us to step back and ask ourselves, how do we today, for our network deployments, actually determine the reliability of those wireless links? And I'm really just going to stay at that link level today. And we're not actually going to talk about a whole lot of technical things. We're not going to talk about a whole lot of frames flying around or how file layers modulate data. We're not going to get into coding and all of the rest that happens that makes the wireless link a wireless link. That's not what I want to talk to you about so much. What I want to talk to you about is how do we make sure when we know all of that other information, we're doing the right things in order to make sure that we actually achieve quality in our wireless links. So we have assurance. The link will be there when we need it to be there. I'm going to give you examples of a couple of different types of tools that we can use. And these are tools like FMEA and FTA. Let's go ahead and begin to take a look. First, terminology. The terminology that we need to define is the reliability, first of all, because I've said the word reliability a couple of times. And reliability is really a subset of this larger concept we call dependability. So let's define that first. Dependability is the trustworthiness of a system such that reliance can be justifiably placed on the service it delivers. Well, that sounds fancy, doesn't it? What's it really mean? Well, a dependable system is a trustworthy system. We can say it that way simply. Something that's trustworthy. We know we can count on it, right? We know it will be there. It really is that simple. But the key thing is note that reliability, availability, and maintainability are aspects of dependability. So if we want dependability, we need reliability. If we want dependability, we need availability. If we want dependability, we need maintainability. All of these things have to be there for us to ultimately have dependability. And reliability is one of the components. Reliability then is defined as the ability of a system or component to perform its required function under stated conditions for a specified period of time. So we have to constrain reliability. We can't simply say reliability is the ability of a system or component to perform its required functions. We have to instead say, well, there have to be some constraints, right? And so one of those is stated conditions, the conditions in which it's expected to operate. Therefore, it would be unfair, for example, if you buy an access point that is designed for indoor use in business environments, and then you deploy it within a mining operation and expect it to have reliability because you've just moved it to the wrong stated conditions, right? So you want it to be able to do its required functions under stated conditions and for a specified period of time. What is a realistic expectation for how long that system will be able to function the way it's supposed to function in the conditions within which it's supposed to be able to function? All of that comes together to define reliability. Now, in the opening of today's conference, I actually mentioned to you there are standards for all of these kinds of things. Well, guess what? These definitions are not mine. These come from the IEEE Standard Dictionary of Measures of the Software Aspects of Dependability. That's right. That's the name of the document. And in addition, I'm going to talk to you about another term that was in my title, and that is assurance. Also coming from a standard, this happens to be ISO IEC IEEE 15026-1, not 2019, called System and Software Engineering, Systems and Software Assurance, Part 1, concepts, and vocabulary. Assurance is grounds for justified confidence that a claim has been or will be achieved. So assurance is linked to claims. If someone makes a claim that they can jump 3 feet in the air with a vertical leap, then assurance that they could do that could be measured in some way. For example, you would probably look at me, and if I made a claim that I could have a vertical leap of 3 feet, you would not have assurance, because there are many things you could look at and measure about me immediately and say, I very seriously doubt Tom has a vertical leap of 3 feet. So claims are justified, claims are supported, and claims also may be stipulated within constraints as well. But assurance is the total collection of grounds, evidence, that justifies your confidence that a claim has been or will be achieved. So for example, if you claim 99.99% uptime for a wireless link, how do you justify that? What are the grounds? What is the evidence? How are you proving that that assurance is real? Assurance may relate to A, would the system or software as specified meet real-world needs and expectations? B, would or does the as-built and operated system meet the specifications, or both A and B? So one of these is just saying, well, we defined some specifications and the system that we've implemented meets them. The other one is saying, okay, the system does more than just meet specifications. In a real-world environment, it's actually going to meet needs and expectations when based on those specifications. So this is the crux of assurance. So we want reliability. We want assurance. How do we get there? Well, let me start by sharing something else with you very briefly. This is a concept that I've been talking to people about for probably about 20 years now. Decisions. How do we make decisions? There are very fancy modeling algorithms and formulas that are used in the world of psychology to evaluate how people make decisions. And in the process of all of this and studying a lot of the literature on this over the years, I've kind of come up with a simplified way to talk about it. And for the first time ever, you're going to see a Tom Carpenter production, a fancy animation on Tom Carpenter's theory of decisions. Okay, here we go. First of all, decisions are always made in time when it comes to human beings. We always make decisions somewhere on the scale of time within our lives. And these decisions then have what you might call a decision point, a point in time within our life when we have to make a decision. We can granularize that and say each day there are points of decision. We can say each week there are points of decision, each year or each decade, and so forth. Now, the reality is that in order to make a decision, we need information, right? So we could say that there is information in the world related to the decision that we'll need to make, and it is some volume and size. It's unknown what that volume is, and it really cannot be known because there's too much information for us to ever say that we now know that we have all of the information related to our decision. But what we do know is that we could use some means to discover that information. So as we travel through life toward the decision point, and that travel might be weeks, it might be minutes, it might be seconds, but as we move toward the decision point, we gain some of that information in the world that's related to the decision that we have to make. The process then could be formalized by saying that the probability of making a good decision is a factor of all of the information in the world related to that decision compared to the information that we possess related to that information in the world and the number of potential decisions. So if you have more options, the likelihood of making the good decision is decreased in relation to the amount of information you have in the total pool of information in the world related to that decision. Okay, so we can make a good or we can make a bad decision, right? That's the way we often think of it. Now, I would suggest to you there is another category, and that's a correct decision. So a good decision, we reflect back on it after having made it. If it turns out well, we say, that was a good decision. If it turns out poorly, we say, that was a bad decision. Well, the reality is that a decision can be correct even though we might later perceive it as bad. Why is that? Well, it's because technically speaking, psychologists would tell us that we've made a correct decision if we've evaluated and taken into consideration all of the information that we had at that time while making the decision, and then made the decision based on that best information. So to us, with what we had in our brains at that moment, we made the correct decision, even though later on, With more information or simply the results of our decision, we may find out that that correct decision for who we were in that space and time was not necessarily a good decision. All right, so all of the philosophy and theory aside, the most important thing to know is that the key to making better decisions is having the right information. So let's talk about that. How do we get information? Well, I'm going to talk to you about a couple of methods that we can use to analyze the systems. It's often used for products, it's used for processes, it's used for services, it's used for other things as well. And these are the failure mode and effects analysis and fault tree analysis method. I do not have the time today because we could spend an entire day or 2 day class just on these concepts, but I want to expose you to them. So I don't have the time to go into great depth, but I want you to see what they are and see the role they could play in helping us to make better decisions, which result in our end goal, reliability and assurance, ultimately in our case, for our wireless links. So failure mode and effects analysis is also sometimes expanded to failure mode effects and criticality analysis. So you'll see that as well sometimes. It is an inductive analysis process. What does inductive mean? Well, you've probably heard of inductive and deductive. Sherlock Holmes was deductive. Inductive indicates you're already in there. It's a good way to remember the difference. Inductive, you're already in there. You're starting at the detail and you're working out to generality. Whereas deductive, you're starting at the generality and working to the details. So FMEA is inductive. And the way it works, there are a few terms you need to know about. You start with a mechanism that causes failure, and that leads to what we call the failure mode. The failure mode, simply defined, is the different ways the system could fail. In the case of wireless links, it's the different ways the wireless link could not work or not work well enough, right? So a mechanism of some sort, something, leads to a failure mode. For example, interference. Then the failure mode, the actual failure, which could be a complete drop of the link, it could simply be increased packet error rates, things like that. The failure mode results in some kind of effects. It could be a potential complete failure, it could be a partial failure. So there are effects that come out of the failure mode. Then the failure effects are what really determine criticality if we're going to analyze criticality in our process. The effects of the failure could be, again, a reduction in throughput, it could be a complete disconnection from the network. And then the failure criticality is what should result in our response plan. So when we know the impact of the failure, the criticality, we can then say, do I want to spend any effort in responding to this, or do I simply not want to spend any effort responding to this, and how much effort? So based on criticality, I can determine the level of effort I'm going to put into making some changes in my environment, adjusting my processes in order to improve the likelihood of having reliable and quality links. So to really drive this home, we'll take a look at an example here. So this is a template. That's right, another spreadsheet. So you can put something like this into an Excel spreadsheet and you can get an idea for the different parts and pieces of your system and what they might do. So if we take an item, like for example, a Zigbee coordinator. Well, the Zigbee coordinator, if we started just by saying the Zigbee coordinator failed, that wouldn't be inductive, that would be deductive. That's more fault tree analysis. So instead, the failure mode to be inductive is we start at the granular level. We have a packet error rate greater than 10%. So if that's the case, we have to ask, if the packet error rate is greater than 10%, what are some of the effects of that? Well, maybe we miss critical messages. What would the severity of that be? Well, they're critical messages, right? So the severity would be a 9. This is usually a 10-point scale when you perform FMEA. And so the severity would be a 9, with a higher number being more severe. The cause or mechanism, the thing that caused this failure mode, in this case, we'll say it's interference. We've got some kind of interference going on the network. The occurrence. So how often is this going to occur? What is the frequency of this taking place? Again, higher is more frequent. So we'll say 6. Now we may have some things already in place to help protect this. I hope you do. We might have proper channel planning, monitoring packet error rate, and so forth, which would lead to the ability to then think about, well, how good are we at detecting that this is happening? So there are three key factors that we're analyzing here: severity, occurrence, and detection. Higher numbers, in this case on the 10-point scale, indicate that it's less detectable. So higher would be worse for detection. This is a 2. Why? Because, well, we're monitoring for packet error rates, right? So we're looking for this kind of thing to occur. The result then is the risk priority number, the RPM. The RPM is simply S times O times D. So severity times occurrence times detection. Now, let me back up from this for just a moment and say that FMEA has been around a very long time. And there are a lot of people that question some of the calculations in this algorithm. But I will tell you this. There have been a whole lot of articles written in journals, papers written on how to improve this and how to make FMEA better. And there's very little agreement on exactly how to make it better for those that disagree with the quality of the process. Here's the thing I would suggest to you. In analyzing all of the research, what I found is that regardless of how accurate you might think the RPN actually is, what everybody tends to agree on is that when you're using the process, those things that have severely high RPNs, closer to 1,000, are certainly things that you want to look at, analyze, and see how you can improve the quality and the reliability and assurance of those things within your system. So then, after the RPN number of 108 for 9 times 6 times 2, we come to recommended actions. Improve monitoring to increase detectability. So we're going to try to take our monitoring to an even higher level. Maybe we'll monitor at the RF level and not just packet error rates. So if we do that, maybe we can get detection to a 1, where we'll detect it every time that this happens. The actions taken then, we implemented SNMP traps and overlay monitoring solutions to improve our monitoring. And maybe because we improved detectability to 1, which would be really hard to do in this case with detecting interference, but let's just play the game out here, then the resulting RPN is only 54. Now remember, that's 54 out of a possible 1,000. So that would be a very low RPN. So you can see now what the FMEA process leads you to do. If we were to go through these various failure modes for our wireless links, for our different protocols, Wi-Fi and IoT alike, then the reality is that not only do we get to an RPN number for what we see it as today, but we can also evaluate what actions we might be able to take. Take those actions and then predict this is what we expect the RPN to be afterwards. In other words, we've improved reliability, we've reduced the likelihood of failure. And so that's the key to this process. Now that's just one of the tools. The next tool is fault tree analysis, FTA, but well, it looks more like this because it's a top-down tree. And so the first thing we need to do if we think about fault tree analysis is all of a sudden we've gone from failure mode and effects analysis to fault tree analysis. What's the difference between fault and failure? Well, generally speaking, we think of a fault as the cause of an outcome, the failure. So something was at fault. Have you ever thought about that? Have you ever said, who's to blame? Who's at fault? Whose fault is this? We're on the playground as children and the teacher comes up and says, stop fighting. We point at the other person and say, it's his fault. And so fault is the cause, right? That's the way we think of it. And then failure is the outcome. Something had a fault which resulted in a failure. Now, fault tree analysis is a top-down approach, and it is deductive. So we might start by simply saying, the access point failed. And then we can go down the tree to talk about the different ways it could fail. It could fail because of maybe two general categories, hardware or software. Then we could also add a third category, maybe power provisioning. And then we could break down that into the different nodes underneath of each of those three categories that could possibly result in those three nodes. And you continue breaking it down until you get to the level of, let me define it the way I do, non-insane levels of detail. In other words, I'm not going to keep on going because if you keep on going, you can have a tree that's 50 levels deep for something that only needed to be 4 or 5 levels deep. Okay? So deductive. We start with something failed and what are the different things that could cause that? What are the different things that could cause those? What are the different things that could cause those until eventually we get to the basic events at the bottom of our tree? Those basic events are sometimes also called the root cause. So let's look at an example here using the nomenclature from FTA analysis processes. We start with the top event, and then we have logic gates. We have and or, and we have others as well, but I'm going to keep it simple here today, and I'll give you a reference at the end to a completely free document that you can download in order to get more details. So we have the top event, and then we have logic gates. Then we have an intermediate event, or maybe multiple of them. And then we have logic gates, if necessary, or we might simply go from that first intermediate event directly to a basic event. And then we might, after another logic gate, have more intermediate events, or again, we might end up at basic events. Now, the key here is that once we've defined a tree like this, we can look at the things within that tree that form the most critical event chains, the things that are the most likely to fail. And that comes through doing mathematical probability analysis. We're not going to get into the details of that today, but I'll again give you a reference later on that will help you out there as well. So let's take this for our links. And I'm going to keep it simple because there are a lot of things that can cause link failure at layer one and layer two of the OSI model. So let's just say for layer one, weak signal strength, interference, faulty hardware, and we'll leave it at that. For layer two, improper security configuration, you know, you put the wrong pre-shared key in, firmware, driver error, etc. So there are all kinds of possible things, right? We're just looking at some examples here in order to understand the process. This information might result in a fault tree analysis like we see here. And this is a partial representation of all the details. So we've got a link failure. So we're going to say, well, it's either layer one or layer two. Now, it's even debatable. There could be times when it could be both layer one and layer two. And there are indeed gates that allow for that in FTA. So if we say, well, it was a layer one failure. Well, what was it? Because we have another gate. And was it weak signal strength? Was it interference? Was it faulty hardware? What is the thing that caused that failure? Now, you can see I haven't gone down to excruciating levels of detail here for two reasons. One, to keep it simple, and two, I couldn't fit more big blocks in the slide. Seriously, though, you can go to a lot more levels of detail if you desire to. Now, what we're going to do next? Well, what we're going to do is after we get a tree, we can calculate probabilities for each node of the tree. This could be based on experience. It could be based on actual analysis of historic events if you have documentation within your environment. And it could be improved with future cases. So after you build out a tree like this, you can keep track in the future if you weren't keeping track in the past of different failures that occur and what caused those failures. And you can document them and bring it in and get more accurate probabilities for these things. Then you can determine likely failure causes based on real data over time. That is to say, based on real data over time, you can predict, well, okay, this link failed. Most likely it was this. Secondarily, it could be this, and so forth. Now think about it. You do this as an expert. Those of you that have been working with wireless for a long, long time, some of you longer than some of the others were alive, right? And those of you that have been doing that, you have expertise through experience, and you almost intuit this. But if you could step back and think about what you're doing, guess what? You've quickly gone through a fault tree in your mind. You've quickly analyzed all the things you know that could cause it. You've analyzed the environment in which the link is operating. You've analyzed the protocols that they're utilizing. And taking all of that into consideration, you've said, it's most likely this. And that's your expertise coming through. Wouldn't it be nice if you could document expertise in some way? Now, we can never perfectly reflect expertise. That's reality. There are always going to be challenges to accomplishing that. But what we can do is we can get much of that expertise through these analysis processes. So you can also pour the knowledge of your FMEA to improve the overall process. So the FTA and the FMEA can work together. Now, here's the key. Why would we go through these processes? Well, think about what we're doing. We're brainstorming, we're thinking, we're working possibly collaboratively in a team. We're getting information, aren't we? And here's the big why then. More information plus analysis of that information in the contextual situation in which there's a link failure results in better decisions, not only for fixing that link failure, but also for reducing the likelihood of link failures in the future through proper configuration and design. So that brings us back to the wonderful first time ever seen in the world, Tom Carpenter production animation on Tom Carpenter's theory of both animations and decisions. Because Tom Carpenter's theory of animations is do whatever PowerPoint lets me do. So here we go. Remember, in time, we have to make a decision. When a link fails, guess what? Your decision point just fell in your lap. You don't have time to walk through the journey, to get more of all of that information that's available in the world related to your problem. Instead, you're at the decision point. So if you haven't already gathered some information, you have no choice but to do your best to make a correct decision. The likelihood that that's going to be a good decision is greatly decreased because you don't have as much information. if you use tools like FMEA, FTA, and these are just examples, they're used heavily in the engineering world. But if you use tools like this and other sources, you know, attending conferences and watching presentations, reading vendor literature and documentation, reading white papers, keeping up to date in your knowledge of how things work and so forth, if you're not continually pouring in information from the community, from published materials, from blogs that so many people in the community create, and from processes like FMEA and FTA, then your information bar will be much lower when compared to all of the information available in the world, and it will be harder to make those decisions. Okay, with that, I'd like to leave you with a link. So I told you, I'd tell you where you can get a free resource. This little booklet that you can download is very detailed about fault tree analysis. It also covers FMEA a little bit and some other analysis methods as well that you might be interested in learning about, some of them for hazardous environments and things like that. It's actually developed and published by the U.S. Nuclear Regulatory Commission, where, you know, failure is a big issue. So if it's good enough for them, maybe it could be helpful for us with our wireless links. So I've given you a bit.ly link here that you can go to download it, or if you just do a search for Fault Tree Handbook, U.S. Nuclear Regulatory Commission, then you'll be able to find it. And this is the best free resource I've seen on FTA and also a little bit of information of FMEA. So download it, enjoy the reading, and prepare when you get to the probability chapters to slow down and take a look at some math. So when it comes to this, in closing, I just want to share with you one final thought on all of this. I'm not telling you that you have to use FTA and that you have to use FMEA. I'm simply telling you that these are tools available to you. And there are others. Some are simpler. Some are way more complex. There are many tools that can help you with this process. I wanted to give you an example of some tools that can help you elicit information out of the minds of all of the people that are there in your environment. And you know, sometimes you might think, well, I don't really have one of those phenomenal experts in my environment like the people that I hear presenting at these conferences. In my environment, we're all maybe at the intermediate level. Yeah, but if you put enough intermediate level people together, you might be surprised how much information you can get when you go through an FMEA or an FTA. So take advantage of the tools, work as a team, and go through the process. And when you run into situations where you're wondering, how could I figure out other things that might cause this or that problem that maybe we haven't experienced yet? There's this wonderful group of people on Twitter that if you go out there and say, hey, Twitter Wi-Fi people, hey, Twitter IoT people, what could cause this kind of problem? Could you give me your top five? You'll be shocked how many experts out there that know their stuff will pause in their life and give you their top five. Or maybe they'll say, I don't know for sure they're my top five, but they've got to be close to the top. And you'll begin to elicit this information. And what's the key to making good information? I can hear you all say it. I know you can say it. What's the key to making good decisions? It's the information that you have compared to all of the information in the world available in relation to that decision. And so if you have more of that information, you will make better decisions. Thank you very much.